humans have been hunting whales for 400 years and probably longer. Only very, very recently did we start hunting whales at an industrial scale. In the lifespan of one large whale, we killed about 1.5 million great whales in the Southern Ocean. That's a biomass of about 3 billion people removed from Earth in 60 to 70 years. Imagine roughly half the human population of Earth disappearing in one human lifespan. That's what happened in the Southern Ocean in the mid-1900s. Scientists at the time predicted other predators of krill, and the krill themselves would explode in numbers. Neither of those things have really happened. Krill populations don't seem to have increased since the removal of whales, but actually decreased. My name is Mathew Savoca. I study large marine animals, and in particular, baleen whales. These are animals that are as large as commercial airliners, and yet we don't know their most basic biology. That's what we set out to do by just asking a simple question: how much food do these large whales need? Without knowing how much food they need, then we don't really understand how these ecosystems work, how much prey might be out there in the ecosystem to support the number of whales that we know exist in that ecosystem. And for this study in particular, there were three main technologies that we took use of. The first is high-resolution movement sensing tags, basically whale iPhones. They have high-resolution accelerometers, magnetometers, GPS, cameras, light sensors. Put it right on the back of a whale, and it can then travel with the whale several hundred meters underwater and can stay on the whale as long as a couple days. We can take the data from these motion sensors on these tags and then reconstruct not just their movement path, but their behaviors. And that has been a real breakthrough in understanding whale ecology, because before the advent of these tags, we didn't really know what they were doing underwater. The second bit of technology are drones. When we tag a whale, we like to measure that whale. Once we measure the size of that animal, we can relate that to the size of the mouth, how big of a gulp of water they can take. You have the tag, which tells you how many gulps of water they were taking in a given period of time, and the drones, which can tell you the size of each of those gulps. The last component is using echo sounders to figure out the density of those krill swarms. Putting those three things together, we can figure out how much these whales are eating per mouthful, per dive, and per day. Large baleen whales only eat about 50 to 100 days a year. And then for the rest of the time, they just don't eat. Unless there's enough krill per cubic meter of water, then these whales will actually lose energy eating. The amazing thing is they do this hundreds of times a day. Imagine eating a buffet while running 3 marathons back to back to back. That's what a day in the life of a feeding whale is like. Before the use of this technology, I don't think anyone really expected them to be feeding that much. Just the quantity of what they eat is astonishing. Sometimes 3 times higher than we expected. As much as 4, 5, 6 tons of krill a day. Therefore, the quantity of what needs to be in ocean ecosystems to support them is also large and important. It makes us rethink and reframe how ocean ecosystems work, how we should manage them, not just for whales, but for people as well. The Weddell Gyre is the largest oceanographic feature in the Southern Ocean, where by far the most whales were and by far the most krill was and is. And we estimate that just the blue and the fin whales there ate roughly 100 million tons of krill there each year prior to whaling. We don't know exactly how much krill was in the system then, possibly as much as 500 million metric tons just in the Weddell Gyre system alone. Now in the Weddell Gyre system, there's about 60 to 70 million metric tons. The difference between these numbers is so stark that even if our estimate for how much whales eat are off by 2 or 3-fold, there's still not enough krill in the Weddell Gyre to recover whale populations to even close to the level we're at pre-whaling. How can we understand the collapse of krill stocks? First, we need to look at ecosystem dynamics. Whales act as mobile krill processing plants. In the Southern Ocean in particular, the whale food web, you have whales that are feeding on krill and krill that are feeding on phytoplankton. The phytoplankton need nutrients to grow. They need iron. Iron is abundant in whale poop. Whales eat krill and they poop out iron-rich feces. The phytoplankton draw in that iron to build those communities of phytoplankton, which then feed the krill, which then feed the whales. Essentially, whales create pastures in the sea that the krill use to eat to thrive. The whales and their prey, the krill, were actually locked in this mutualism where they both need each other. The whales need the krill just as much as the krill need the whales. When we removed the whales, we pulled the plug on this ecological mutualism that really held this whole ecosystem together. And that system has since fallen apart. Right now, most of the Weddell Gyre is a biological desert. We believe that the removal of whales drove this initial decline, and climate change is limiting its recovery. On top of that, we're competing with the whales for the krill that remains. Krill fishing is happening in the Southern Ocean even today. Now, we are harvesting only 1% of the krill population in that area where this krill fishing takes place. That seems completely fine. And it is, if your goal is to just have that population be replaced year after year. But if you think about the importance of krill to Antarctic predators, even the removal of half of 1 million tons of krill, if it overlaps in space and time with these krill predators, could be very detrimental. If krill swarms get large enough and dense enough, they become immensely valuable to whales. And they're also quite uncommon. The issue is, as management currently stands, those are also the patches that are the most valuable to the krill fishery. These hyper-dense patches of krill, the same very patches that we know these whales are feeding on and are dependent on to survive and reproduce. It's easy to break an ecosystem, and it's very hard to put it back together. If we want to rebuild whales to anything even remotely close to what we saw before whaling, we need more krill, period. It's just simple math. It became quite clear we really need to stop hunting whales altogether at this industrial scale if we want whales on the planet at all. And so in the early 1980s, there was a global whaling moratorium. Since the moratorium, humpback whales around the world are recovering extremely well. So this is something that we need to celebrate. These conservation measures do work, and humpback whales are a great example of that. But unfortunately, other whales are not doing so well. Antarctic blue whales are still at about 1% of their historic population size 60 years after we stopped hunting them. What you can lose in 50 years might take 500 years or more to grow back. We need to think really carefully about how we protect these resources moving forward. If we bring back whales, the whales will help us bring back the krill. And that's a situation we all want, whether we're a penguin or a whale or a person. This is important in the fight against climate change. Once carbon is brought into a whale's body, it's locked in there for decades and in some cases centuries. Krill are also super important in the carbon cycle because they have really fast sinking fecal pellets, which sink and lock that carbon away to the deep sea. This process of rebuilding whales and krill and the phytoplankton in this very simple food chain of the giants is going to be incredibly important in the 21st century in storing and sequestering at least a couple gigatons of carbon. We have about 1,000 too many gigatons of carbon in the atmosphere. So will the rebuilding of this ecosystem, will that solve climate change? Alone, no. But we take all of these natural climate solutions, rebuilding forests, rebuilding fish populations, recovering grasslands. If we consider the recovery of whales and their ecosystems as part of these natural climate solutions, whales are just a slice of the pie, but they are a part of the pie that we need to consider. If we want to make impacts on large scales, then I think what we need to do is share this message of hope as widely and as quickly as we can. We know how to tell stories. Now we have that ability, but we can disseminate that information so much quicker. So let's take that opportunity. Let's use that technology to build an army of planetary warriors. The most important is to just have protected areas where there is limited or no take of Antarctic wildlife. In the areas where we do fish for krill, reconsider how we're doing it so that there's not direct overlap between krill fishing and Antarctic predators. The next couple decades will have rippling effects throughout the next several centuries and maybe even millennia of planetary history. That's how important this time, this moment is for us. And for me, that's an exciting time and an exciting place to be.
Thank you.